Subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get the latest updates.
The most cluttery thing which is of importance to India is actually not happening in India. It's happening around India, a little bit close to India, and then generally in a region that matters greatly to India, that is the Islamic world in general, but Pakistan in specific. Now, we've seen this tamasha over the past couple of weeks with Mahathir, the Malaysian Prime Minister, 94-year-old, young, senile man, offering to hold this big summit of Islamic nations to discuss the Ummah's biggest problems. And he was collecting everybody from the Islamic world, and I think he had to be very optimistic to think that he will create one more forum and he will get Iran and Saudis and Turkey and the Pakistanis and everybody to get together. Ultimately, that didn't happen. What is of relevant to us is, to us in India, is the fact that Pakistan was meant to attend that summit, but at the last moment, Pakistan pulled out, which was a big humiliation, because I'll take you back to the UN General Assembly in New York. In UNGA sessions, only two foreign heads of states or foreign governments had attacked India over Kashmir. Turkey, that's Erdogan, and Malaysia, that is Mahathir. Mahathir, if anything, was even nastier than Erdogan in his speech, in his mention of Kashmir. Now, after that, I think Imran Khan also, it obviously got him excited. And these three held a meeting on the sidelines of UN General Assembly, that is Erdogan, Mahathir and Imran Khan. And they said that Islamic world was getting a bad name, that Islamic world was actually a victim of terrorism, etc., etc. But they were getting a bad name and Islam was getting a bad name. So they should start getting together and hold a summit to discuss these issues. And they also talked about floating a or launching a new TV channel, a global TV channel, to give people the correct information about Muslims and Muslim countries and Muslim issues as a counter to the Western media, which is biased. So this summit in Kuala Lumpur was set up as a consequence of that. So to that extent, Imran Khan was central to that. You know, in boxing, wrestling, in contact sports, there is the concept that you should fight within your own weight class. If you are 68 kilos, you should fight in the 68 kilo. But if you are 68 kilos and you fight in the super heavyweight class, then you are bound to get clobbered very quickly and suffer some damage also. So Pakistan, since they came back from UNGA, tried to fight in a much higher weight class. Now, first of all, Imran Khan would have been poorly advised if his diplomats, Pakistani diplomats are quite smart, if they told him that he should get into mediating between the big guys in the Muslim world, that is Iran and Saudi Arabia. So he came in, he went running to Iran, then he went to Saudi Arabia, offering to or threatening to or pretending to mediate between the two. I mean, the response to which, really, the good response to which should have been, look who's talking. Because Pakistan simply doesn't have that stature, and Imran Khan within his own country does not have that stature. Then the summit in Kuala Lumpur. Now, this summit was being attended by Iran at a high level, by Rouhani himself, Iranian president, which is quite interesting given the fact that Malaysia actually is known to give Shia Muslims the roughest treatment. In fact, the safest thing for a Shia in Malaysia is to not let anybody know that he is a Shia. Yet, enemy is your friend. Iran's big rival is Saudi Arabia. Qatar's big rival is Saudi Arabia. Turkey's big rival is Saudi Arabia. So they all thought this summit was a good way of producing a counter to organize OIC, which is Saudi dominated. But Saudis also saw through this, and they saw red all over this. So Saudis don't have much leverage over Turkey, Qatar, or to some extent Malaysia, but they have leverage over Pakistan. They are paying Pakistan's bills. They also put money in State Bank of Pakistan to keep Pakistan's balance of payments going. They've given Pakistan grants. they employ 4 million Pakistanis. So the Saudis got furious and they summoned Imran Khan, this time not to seek his mediation between them and Iran, but to say, hey, what the hell are you doing? So they blew the whistle on Imran and he came back with his tail between his legs. And then Pakistan said, we are not going to Kuala Lumpur. But once again, the Pakistanis said, now we are trying to mediate between the Saudi king and Mahathir of Malaysia. So there were some pretense, they were trying to set up a call between them. So Mahathir would himself invite the king of Saudi Arabia. There was usual feudal tamasha that no, Mahathir should himself go there to invite him, which was never going to happen. And even when Mahathir offered to do so, the Saudis did not find a convenient enough date for him to go there, obviously because they did not want this summit. So Pakistan got left out, that was humiliation enough. But Erdogan, who is a friend of Pakistan's, he was also humiliated because Pakistan, which was a key initiator of this project, pulled out at the last moment, and that too under pressure from Saudis, who Erdogan doesn't like. So Erdogan gave an interview to his country's media where he said, look, Pakistan was coming, but Saudis have a lot of leverage over Pakistan. Saudis told the Pakistanis, one, we'll throw out your 40 lakh, 4 million workers, and we'll hire Bangladeshis instead of them. Number two, we'll pull out our money from State Bank of Pakistan. And number three, don't count on us to keep filling up your deficit and to keep your foreign exchange reserves going. So he said Pakistan had no choice, so Pakistan withdrew. Now that was really rubbing Pakistan's nose in the ground, and this was done by an ally, by Erdogan. When that happened, then obviously Pakistan is complete to Saudi Arabia, and Saudi foreign minister came to Pakistan, and Pakistanis insisted that, look, if you don't want us to get involved in other such activity, in fact Pakistanis said officially that the reason they were not going to Kuala Lumpur was that they thought that such conferences or such deliberations should now be held with a larger consensus among the Islamic world, and because Saudi Arabia and UAE were not at ease with this, they were not doing this, because they can't be taking all their money from Saudi Arabia and UAE then conspiring with their rivals in the Islamic world to it's very difficult to explain this, although in diplomacy, squeeze play is a legitimate tactics, which means you squeeze one side to get something from them, and usually you squeeze one side by pretending to do something with the other side, which is this side's rival. So this was squeeze play Pakistan was trying. It went wrong twice. Third time they thought, just as a face saver, that maybe Saudis can hold an OIC summit where Kashmir will also be discussed. Now, that did happen. The story came out in the Times of India. Indrani Bagchi broke that story a couple of days back. But then, now it looks like the Saudis have second thoughts, because Pakistan is not the only player in the game. It's the game of diplomacy and everybody has their stakes. So now it seems that, one, the Saudis do not want this summit in any case to be in Saudi Arabia. So it can be in some other country. Likely at this point, it looks like the Pakistanis will say they will host it. Now, any summit being held in Pakistan, calling India names will have zero meaning. But more importantly, I think Saudis and others have also let Pakistan know that, look, all this is fine, but this doesn't have to be a summit, heads of state summit. This can be a foreign minister level summit. Now, at that level, OIC passes resolutions against India in a routine manner, so nobody cares about that. Now, what is behind all this? And why did I say Pakistan is fighting in a much higher weight class? Because we have to understand the politics of the Islamic world. How many Muslims are there in the world? About 1.8 billion, plus minus a little bit, about 180 crore Muslims. I mean, just notionally, more than one third of them live in the subcontinent. That is India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, some in Sri Lanka, some in Nepal, Maldives, but essentially in these countries. Yet, there is a big imbalance in the Islamic world. And what is the imbalance? The imbalance says that the biggest power, the dominant power in the Islamic world is held by countries not with the largest populations, but among the smallest populations. So while researching this, I found a website, which seems quite an interesting website, which is called 500 more most influential Muslims, and they do this count every year, and I'm just watching it on what they are doing, and I see 2019, who's number one? Mr. Erdogan, most influential Muslim in the world. His population is just 8 crores. Second most influential, King Abdullah of Jordan. His population is 97 lakhs. That's all. Then you come to Saudi Arabia, the Sheikh Salman Abdulaziz, he's the ruler, not the crown prince. He's the ruler. His population, 3.2 crores. Number four, Khamenei, he is the strong man of Iran. His population, 8 crores. So Iran, Saudi Arabia, Turkey, Jordan, all together have fewer Muslims than the state of Pakistan. And yet these top four are the most four most powerful people. Just for academic reasons, if you want to know where do the rest feature, so Imran Khan features at number 29, despite having the second largest Muslim population in the world after Indonesia. And in fact, just 3 slots after him features the only Indian in that list, and that's our dear friend Maulana Mehmood Madani, whose mosque is just next door from our office in Delhi. So that's what tells you a little bit about the pecking order in the Islamic world, because it's one of those vagaries of divine mind that the largest Muslim countries have the fewest resources, largest in terms of population. So resources, oil and the rest are with countries with small populations. Now, in this, within this Islamic universe, there are many rivalries. And those rivalries, some come down from history, some come down from nostalgia, and some come from real politic today, and some have superpower interest also. Now, if you look at this carefully, then the most powerful country in that region historically has been Turkey. In the past, all of us have heard of the Ottoman Empire, 14th century to early 20th century. They controlled large parts of what is today the Middle East, North Africa, a lot of Europe, right up to the Balkans. That was all Ottoman Empire. The inheritor of that nostalgia is who else but number one man, number one on this influential Muslims list, that is Erdogan. He's turned Turkey around. Turkey, he's thrown out most of the civil liberties, he's thrown more journalists in jail than almost any country in the world. Because China, you don't get the count, accurate count, but a lot of journalists have been thrown in jail. There is a lot of corruption. He's appointed his son-in-law, his finance minister. He's appointed himself the chief executive officer, CEO of Turkey's own sovereign wealth fund. To that extent, he has made Turkey much more a classical Islamic country now. Turkey used to be quite a liberal Europe-style democracy. In fact, Turkey was close to being a full member of EU. It's a member of NATO. But now Turkey has gone towards heavy Islamization. Now, why has that happened and what is all this happening? Maybe at some other point of time I will talk about this in more detail. But as Arab Spring came around 2011 or so, initially Turkey and Saudi Arabia supported Arab Spring, because Arab Spring essentially was against old dictators, ideological Baathist kind of dictators in Egypt, Libya, Syria, etc., who were essentially secular or relatively secular. So Islamic forces were happy that they were being thrown out. But once they were thrown out, Muslim Brotherhood began to take over. As Muslim Brotherhood began to take over, Turkey was quite happy because Erdogan thinks that AKP is a bit like Muslim Brotherhood. But others got very unhappy. So Saudi Arabia got very insecure, and because Muslim Brotherhood was then talking of taking American influence out, and was also saying that many of these old ruling families in the Muslim world were compromised to Western power. So it became very important for Saudi Arabia and for Israel to get that Morsi's Muslim Brotherhood government out of Egypt. So they got it out. Turkey did not want that to happen, and that led to conflict between Turkey. Conflict means diplomatic conflict, nothing on the ground. Qatar is a very rich country. Qatar also is a country that does not treat Iran as a hostile. In fact, Iran is a friend. Qatar and Iran share a gas field. So this alliance then comes into being. Qatar, Turkey, Russia, Iran. In walks another man, now this time a much older man than Imran, that is Mahathir, also punching above his weight. And he thought he will now hold a summit of all these people in his capital. Can you imagine with Iran, Turkey, Qatar and the rest going to Kuala Lumpur for this summit? How would the Saudis feel? So Pakistan miscalculated by getting involved in this. Now it's licking its wounds and also nursing its pride a little bit. Now I don't know whether some kind of an OIC thing will happen in Pakistan or not, or someplace. If it's a foreign minister level thing, it will have no meaning.